In this video, we'll use ice in Softimage to create this charring effect. Along the way, we'll highlight many of the basic aspects of the ice framework, like custom attributes and context. Here is the scene that we'll use as a starting point. The flame is a particle system based on the ice candle scene in the XSI Samples project. It's been modified to make the particles flow around the branch. However, the flame doesn't cause any charring yet. Here's the compound that we'll use to shrivel the branch. It uses two turbulence fields with different frequencies to move points inward along their normals. Let's delete that deformation for now and think about how to control the shriveling effect. Your first thought might be to try to imitate real life, maybe create a heat attribute on the flame particles and have them add a bit of heat to areas of the branch as they flow around it. However, that's not going to work because the contexts are different. The heat would be an attribute of the particles, but the attribute that we want to affect is the point positions of the branch. So, we need to start in the point context of the branch, for example by getting the branch's point positions and looking for nearby flame particles. Another aspect of the effect is that the branch doesn't keep shriveling indefinitely. At some point it gets burnt up and doesn't shrivel any further. We can control that by using a custom attribute to keep track of how much burnable matter is left in the branch. In the simulation, we can subtract from that value until it's all used up, and use the amount that still remains to control the amount of shriveling. One good thing about this approach is that we could use a weight map to paint different amounts of energy in different areas. We could also use maps or attributes to control how fast different areas burn, and so on. But let's keep it simple for this example. Create a non-simulated ice tree in the modeling region of the branch's stack. In this tree, create a custom scalar attribute and call it stored energy. Set it to 1 for now. In the simulation, we'll be subtracting from this value until it's all used up. If you show the attribute's values now, you can see there's only one value. That's because the attribute is in the object context. The object context is the default, when nothing forces an attribute into a different context. You'll see that change a bit later. We'll also store the same value as original energy, so that we can know how much has been used up. Then we'll store the current point positions as original point position so that we can interpolate against them later. Because this ice tree is in the modeling region of the stack, it won't get re-evaluated during the simulation. So even though we are setting the value to the current point positions, the attribute will always contain the original, pre-simulated point positions. Finally, we'll also store the current point normals as original point normal for the same reason. Remember, the normals determine the direction of the shriveling effect, and the actual normals will change constantly as the shape changes during the simulation. Now it's time to set up the simulation itself. Create a simulated ice tree on the branch. As we mentioned, we need to subtract energy from the branch's points when there are particles nearby. So get a reference to the branch's point positions, and get the closest points on the point cloud. The cutoff distance to use will depend on the size of the particles and the amount of falloff that you want. In this case, a value of about 4 should work. Since there will often be more than one nearby particle, their locations are returned as an array. You need to get their positions and then get the distance between them and the points on the branch. The distance is larger when the particles are further away, but the charring effect should get stronger when the particles are closer. To account for this, you need to invert the distance. If you are familiar with the physical laws for the intensity of things like heat, light, and sound, you know that they follow an inverse square relation over distance. This example isn't meant to be physically accurate, but it's easy enough to square the inverse by multiplying it by itself. At this point, we still have an array of values, so we can't subtract it from the stored energy just yet, because it's a single value. Each nearby particle will make the points on the branch lose a bit of energy, so the total amount of energy loss will be the sum of the array, which you can get with the getArraySum node. Connect the result to a multiply node so that you have some control over the rate of energy loss. Use a factor of 1 for now. Subtract the result from the current stored energy to get the new stored energy value. However, we don't want the value to keep decreasing indefinitely and become negative, so connect a max node and set the second value to 0. So now, if a point loses more energy than it's got left, the stored energy stays at the maximum of the two values, which is 0. Finally, use the result to set the new value for stored energy. If you advance a frame and display the stored energy values, you can see that now there's one value per point. Because stored energy is being modified based on the closest particles to each point's position, the attribute has been forced into the per point context. The new context is more restrictive than the object context was, and you won't be able to change context again while these nodes are connected. If you play the simulation and move the match under the branch, you can see the values decreasing. Now it's time to use those values to control the shriveling effect. We're going to do that in the simulation region. If we did it in the post-simulation region instead, the branch's points would still be in their original positions during the simulation, so the particles would flow around the original shape, rather than the deformed shape. First, we need to calculate the proportion of energy that's been used up. That's equal to the original energy minus the stored energy, all divided by the original energy. We're going to use that value as a blend factor for interpolating between the original point positions and the shriveled point positions. That's why we stored the original point positions. In the middle of the simulation, the current point positions are already partly interpolated. If we used them to interpolate against the fully shriveled point positions, we wouldn't get the correct result. For the same reason, we stored the original point normals to use as a direction for the shrivel effect. The current normals would keep changing as the current point positions change. Now run the simulation. You can see that the shriveling happens far too quickly. One way to handle this is to increase the original amount of energy so that it takes longer to get used up. Try setting it to 1,000. You can also adjust the multiplication factor in the simulated tree to decrease the rate at which energy gets consumed. You can continue tweaking these values until you are satisfied with the effect. The final part is to use the energy to control the color so that we get some charring along with the shriveling. In the render tree, use a mix between the original Fong and a very dark Lambert. Use the same formula to calculate the blend. Original energy minus stored energy, all divided by original energy. The blend weight of the Mix Two Colors node is a color value, so convert the scalar value to a color. Draw a render region to see the result, a charred and shriveled branch. So in this tutorial, we built a couple of operators to achieve a custom effect. We solved the problem with an understanding of context and locations, and implemented the solution using custom attributes. Along the way, we used references to get and set the data we needed.